We're going to be getting into Christianity today. We've gone through world religions. We've went through Judaism. Then we talked about Roman Catholicism, Islam, Mormonism, Jehovah's Witness, to kind of get an idea or understanding of what they believe. And when we did that, it was for the purpose and benefit of us to have an idea of their beliefs so that when we engage with them, we can represent them to the best of our ability without strawmanning. Strawmanning is where you make arguments against someone's position that is not their position. And that happens often. In apologetics, we call it a strawman argument. It's a fallacy because you're basically building up a scarecrow or a strawman so that you can burn it down, and the person's like, it's not even what I believe. So of course you're going to defeat the argument because I don't believe that. And we don't like when that happens to us as Christians. And so we want to be fair in representing what these other false religions do believe so that we can come off in grace, with humility, and in love. Because ultimately our desire is we want to reach them for Jesus Christ. Our desire should never be first and foremost because we just want to win debates, right? We have the truth with Christianity, so the truth is always going to, it's always going to defeat or outshine the darkness or the lies, right? Truth is always going to stand tall against the lies. But our heart's desire should always be because we want to see these individuals come to faith. And but today we are going to start with Christianity. And the reason that we want to take this slow, we want to go through this, because I think it's very important. I talked about this. I'm very excited about getting into Christianity because we want to see what it is we believe and affirm as Christians. Because it's good now to know about some of those beliefs from those other religions, but a lot of times there's a lot of Christians that are new to the faith, or they've even been in the faith for a long time, and they really don't have, at times, a grasp of what it is to be Christian. What does it mean that we hold to the Christian faith? And so we're going to get into that here with this series that we're starting on Christianity. So today, lesson one, we're going to get into the introduction of the Holy Scriptures. We're going to talk about the Word of God. I think I've got over 50 slides. I got 50 slides on the Word of God. And this may take us, obviously, more than 1 week. Pat said to be slow, so we're going to go slow through this. And because we want to all benefit and grow from this. And that is our goal. So let us pray, and then we will get into this. Gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for another beautiful day that you've given us to come together to worship you here on the Lord's Day, to learn from your word, to learn about your word. Father, I pray that you would be with me as I teach this class. I pray that you would be with us as we, those that are here to hear and listen and learn, that we would all grow from this, Lord, and that when we think about your word, when we think about what you have given to us in your word, that we can trust it and know that it is your word that leads us and guides us, that is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And Father, we pray that you would help us today to grow in our understanding for your word and our love for your word, and that we would take the things that we learn and hear from your word and not just hear them, but apply them to our lives. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. All right, so the introduction to the Scriptures. The Bible is the word of God. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says, all Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. 2 Peter 1:21 says that no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So this wasn't just men coming up with these ideas on their own. This was the Spirit moving these men to write out these prophecies, to write out the Word of God. And as it says in Timothy, it's all breathed out by God. Okay? Now, the inspiration, you may hear this word when we talk about Scripture, that the Word of God is inspired. It's the breathed out, right? Inspired Word of God. So inspiration, when we think about what inspiration is, right? And again, this week, this lesson that we're going through is teaching on the Word of God, because we want to be able to be sure that this Bible that we pick up, whatever your translation is, mine's ESV, extra saved version. No, I'm just kidding. The ESV is what I use, but there's the NASB, and we're going to talk about some different translations at the end. I don't think we'll get there today, but you want to be sure that when you have your Bible in your hand, that you can trust it's God's Word, right? It's God's Word. And so when we talk about inspiration, it's the process by which God worked through the human authors of the Bible to communicate His revelation. The term derives from the Greek theopneustos, excuse me if I'm not pronouncing that right, but meaning it's God-breathed, as we read in 2 Timothy 3:16, and refers to God as the ultimate source of the Scriptures, right? It's the ultimate source of the Scriptures. Now, God used the men to write the Scriptures, and He used it in their own way of putting it forth. So in the way that Paul would speak, or the way that Peter would speak, the way that John would speak, that all came out of them, but it was ultimately the ultimate source of God through them. That's why you see the differences in the writings between maybe Paul and Peter, and Peter even saying, some of Paul's writings are hard to understand, you know, and some people come along and they try to pervert that like they do the rest of the Scriptures. And so it's God is the ultimate source of the Scriptures, even though He uses the way in which the men who authored it, their own likeness, their own way of speaking, their own way of writing. The Bible says all Scripture has been breathed out by God. He is saying that this is from R.C. Sproul. He's saying that its ultimate origin is in Him. It is His Word. It is His speech. He is the one who is the source of these writings. And so when we talk about the doctrine of inspiration, we're talking about the way in which God superintends the writing of sacred Scripture, that God does not just act and let people respond with their own insight or their own imagination to set forth their view of what God has done, but that God is working by the Holy Spirit to superintend that record to make sure that the record that is written is His Word. Okay. Now, another word that we hear when we talk about the Word of God is the sufficiency of God's Word. So, Carl Truman has these 4 points here of what this means as the sufficiency of God's Word. First, Scripture is sufficient as the noetic or intellectual ground of knowledge of God. This means that all theological affirmations are to be consistent with the teaching of Scripture. So everything that we believe, because theology is important, theology is the study of God. Everything that we believe about theology, the doctrines that we hold, has to be found and consistent with the Scripture. It has to be consistent with the Scripture. Now, there are times where we may disagree on some things, and maybe we interpret a passage differently, right? But our ultimate authority has to go back to the Scripture, and the Scripture is the final authority. And because man is fallible, sometimes we can be wrong, but we should always be willing to go where the Scripture leads, where the Scripture leads us. Second, Scripture is sufficient for Christian practice. Scripture offers principles which guide believers in their day-to-day lives. I mean, how often do you're living out your life, and because you've got the Word of God indwelling in your heart, because you're reading it, you're meditating it, you're memorizing it, and something comes about and you respond in a certain way because the Spirit of God with the Word of God is in your heart, and it causes you to live out in such a way that is different from the rest of the world, because we have this to guide us in our day-to-day lives. Third, at the level of the church as an institution, Scripture is again sufficient for the principles of both organization and public worship. So when it comes to how do we do church? Why do we do church? What's behind the way we set up and organize church? We find these things in Scripture. Okay? Fourth, in terms of public worship, Scripture is sufficient for establishing its elements, singing of praise, prayer, the reading and preaching of God's Word, the giving of tithes and offerings for the work of the church, baptism, and the Lord's Supper. So this is what we talk about when we speak about sufficiency of Scripture. Now, another word you will hear when speaking about the Scriptures, the Word of God, is inerrancy. Okay? Is it too small? Is it too small?
Huh?
Is it too small?
No, that's good.
Okay. I tried to make them as big as I could. I didn't know how they'll show up better, but inerrancy. So, every word of God proves true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in Him. Proverbs 30 and verse 5. The Scriptures cannot be broken. John 10:35. The purity of Scripture lies in the fact that it stands complete in itself, without error, deceit, or without either deceit or error. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. That's Psalm 12:6. And it's coming out of William Perkins, the father of English Puritans, The Art of Prophesying. Inerrant simply means without error or true, in the sense that we normally speak of true sentences, true doctrines, true accounts, true principles. Were God to speak to us in person directly, none of us would dare to charge Him with error. Errors arise from ignorance or deceit, and our God is neither ignorant nor is He a deceiver. Similarly, we dare not change or charge His written word with error. This is from John Frame, a quote from him. So there is no error in God's word. Now, we have to understand when we're talking about the inerrancy of Scripture, the original Scriptures in the Greek, in the Hebrew, were without error, they were inerrant. We can trust that our English translations are without error in the sense that the doctrines, everything that is being taught from them, there is no error in there. Now, if you are a critical scholar, you do textual criticism, where you dig into the actual Hebrew and the Greek and see how it's translated into the English, what you'll find is, when you look in the Old Testament, a scribe had to be very meticulous, or meticulous? Is that the right word? Meticulous, thank you. With how they transcribed it. Every little detail had to be perfect. And if they messed up, they had to scrap it, start over again. And they would take different pens. Every time they'd write the name of God, they'd have to. Very meticulous in the way that they transcribed it. Well, when Christianity was brought forth, right, and it's spreading now and these letters are being written, it wasn't to the same degree as the scribes. They weren't like trying to make sure everything was copied exactly perfect. They didn't have a lot of money, so they would write it on the back of some papyri, and they would turn it over and write it on the other side. They would try to use everything they had to send these letters out. And so sometimes it would bleed through when you come to the other side, and you may have a mark, or you may have what looks like, as they're copying, an O. Like, if we all wrote, if I gave you a sentence to write, and we all wrote it, in not cursive, but in printed, we're going to have some differences. That's why you have these, what are those people that they go and they check the people's handwritings? You know what I'm talking about, for law, or they inspect it and see, oh, does this person's handwriting match up, right? We would have things that are particular to us, the way I write my O's, or the way I write I's or C's, whatever, right? And you may have differences. So when people are writing those things, little things may happen within the text of as they're transmitting it, or they're copying it and putting it down. But they're very small. Very small. And they're not anything that changes any doctrine. That's why we know that when they're translating, or when they are taking these manuscripts that we have, they are without error. Even if they put a comma in the wrong spot because there was a mark or something bled on the paper, it never changed the doctrine. It never changed the teaching. We can still trust it in English that what we have is the very Word of God. Okay? Sola Scriptura. Maybe you've heard this one as well. I'm sure we've said that multiple times here at this church. We talk about we are Sola Scriptura. Not soli Scriptura. Soli means only the Bible. We are Sola Scriptura, which means the Scriptures are our final authority. Okay? But we do use other books, just like I had a conversation with someone not too long ago, and they were saying, oh, you Reformed people, you read a lot of other books and whatnot. Well, yeah, we read because we are trying to learn and gain more insight, more understanding of what God's Word is saying. And there's many men who have come before us. When you come and sit before a pastor, you're getting that as well, because you're listening to someone who has taken the time to read a passage, to dig into the passage, to try to understand the passage so that they can preach it to you to help you understand what God's saying better, right? And so, soli scriptura would be, we're only scripture, we don't read anything else, it's just Bible only. Sola scriptura is saying, no, we do read other things, but the scripture is always our final authority. So when I read something from Calvin, or I read something from John Owen, and if it doesn't line up with scripture, who's right and who's wrong? It's not Calvin, it's not Owen, it's the scripture. Right, so the scripture is the final authority, while we can still use other writings to help us understand it, we always have to go back to the scripture to be that sole final authority on whatever that doctrine may be or teaching. So, James White says, the doctrine of sola scriptura simply states that the scriptures and the scriptures alone are sufficient to function as the regula fide, or the rule of faith, for the church. All that one must believe to be a Christian is found in Scripture, and in no other source. That which is not found in Scripture is not binding upon the Christian conscience. To be more specific, I provided the following definition. The Bible claims to be the sole and sufficient rule of faith for the Christian church. The Scriptures are not in need of any supplement. Their authority comes from their nature as God-breathed revelation. Their authority is not dependent upon man, church or council. The scriptures are itself consistent, self-interpreting, and self-authenticating. The Christian church looks to the scriptures as the only and sufficient rule of faith, and the church is always subject to the word and is constantly reformed thereby. Now, the Cambridge Declaration says this about sola scriptura. We reaffirm the inerrant scripture to be the sole source of written divine revelation, which alone can bind the conscience. The Bible alone teaches all that is necessary for our salvation from sin and is the standard by which all Christian behavior must be measured. We deny that any creed, council, or individual may bind a Christian's conscience, that the Holy Spirit speaks independently of or contrary to what is set forth in the Bible, or that person's spiritual experience can ever be a vehicle of revelation. So when we talk about what's being stated here by Cambridge and by James White, is it is the Word of God that can bind our conscience, not something outside of that. Not that creeds, so don't hear this wrongly, not that creeds or councils can't be useful and helpful, but they cannot bind your conscience so long as they are not in line with the Scripture. It is the Scripture alone that can bind your conscience. Now, there are things in Scripture that we may read and our conscience may, our own conscience, our personal convictions may be different. There are some things absolutely in Scripture that we know are wrong. Do not lie. Do not steal. That's wrong. Don't do it, right? We know that. We can read that. But there are some things in Scripture. Let's take alcohol, for instance. There are some churches that preach and teach that you have to abstain from all alcohol whatsoever. And then there are other churches that say, well, drunkenness is a sin, that's clear in the Bible, so you don't want to get drunk, but we also see that it's not grape juice, it's actual wine, it's actual alcohol that is being used in the Scripture, and some would say you can drink so far as it's in moderation, or so far as you don't cross that line. Now, for one individual, depending on wherever you fall, right, I'm not here to tell you which side to fall on, but depending on whatever side you fall on that, right, your conscience, your personal conviction cannot be used to bind another individual's conscience. They have to read through the Scriptures and come to that conviction themselves, right? Another example, head coverings. You get to Corinthians chapter 11, and I read it, and some people read it, and they'll see, okay, there's head coverings here. Women should wear head coverings. And then others will read it and say, I don't believe women should wear head coverings because I believe it is a cultural thing. So we don't want to then bind everyone else to the conviction we have through reading that. We want to ultimately come to truth, but we don't want to bind somebody's conviction based upon what we're reading and we're being convicted by. So some things are absolutely clear, and then other things we look at, and I may have a conviction that you may not have. And so we don't want to bind that conviction upon another. and we want to give grace, right? Now, there's two types of revelation, okay? Two types of revelation. You have general or natural, same thing, it's either general or considered natural revelation. And then you have special revelation, okay? And so we're going to look at some scriptures. So if you guys can open your Bibles, if somebody can get Psalm 8, 1 through 3 for me. Psalm 8, 1 through 3. If someone else can get Psalm 19, 1 through 6 for me. So the first one was Psalm chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. Next one, if somebody can grab Psalm 19, 1 through 6. And then if someone else can grab Isaiah 40, verses 12 through 14. Got a couple here, so bear with me. And then Acts 14, 12 through 17. And then I'll grab the last one, Romans. All right, so Psalm 8, 1 through 3. Who has that for me?
I have it. 8, 1 through 3. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise. Because of your enemies, dishonest the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place.
Yes. So this is dealing with natural revelation, general revelation. The unbeliever can look at the world, they can look at God's creation and see the handiwork of God. That's what we're going to read here. Psalm 19, 1 through 6. Who's got that? Leon?
The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens he has pitched a tent for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is hidden from its heat.
I mean, when we read these scriptures and God is just laying it out for us here, that we look at that. I personally, and I'm sure you feel the same, I don't know how anyone can look at the beauty of, even look at the snow. I mean, you look at the beauty, not one snowflake is the same, right? That's what they tell us, right? Science, but it's beautiful, right? And you look at it, now it's cold, people don't like driving in it, but it's the beauty of God's creation. The four seasons, we see this. And you look at everything that God created, and I don't know how you can look at God's creation and say, there's no such thing as God. I don't know how you can do that. When you look at the beauty of God's creation. And so Isaiah 40, verses 12 through 14. Who's got that? Elisa.
Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and meted out heaven with a span and comprehended the dust of the earth in a measure and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who hath directed the spirit of the Lord, or being his counselor hath taught him? With whom took he counsel and who instructed him and taught him in the path of judgment and taught him knowing knowledge and showed to him the way of understanding?
Who teaches the Lord? Right? He's created all these things. And I think, as she mentioned about, you know, measuring the waters, and you know, there's parts of the sea and the oceans that people still have never been able to explore. I mean, imagine that. There's places they can't even get down and explore. What's in those deepest, darkest areas? There's jungles in the world that people haven't even gone back into yet. You know, just you think about that. Right? It's amazing, the creation of God. Acts 14, 12 through 17. Yes, you got it?
Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. the priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bowls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd, shouting, "Men, why are you doing this? We too are only men, human like you. When we bring you good news, tell you to turn from your worthless things to the living God who made heaven and earth and sea and everything in them. In the past, he let all nations go their own way."
So Paul and Barnabas are saying, look, you know, God, the one true God, he's the creator of everything. He's created it all, right? And this is why, again, I say, when I look at God's creation, there's no way possible that we should come up with this idea that there is no creator. There is no God. Because there's just, nothing doesn't come from, or something doesn't come from nothing, right? Now I know people will say, well, where did God come from? Well, God's eternal. God is the source from which everything comes. So there is a source. It's not a circular reasoning in that sense. It's God is the source from all things which flow. All things flow from that or come from him. All right, Romans 1, 19 through 21 says, "For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, in the things that have been made, so that they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened." So everyone that stands before God on the day of judgment, as it says in Romans 1, is without excuse because they already know the God that exists. His creation cries out and screams out, there's a creator, there's a God. Now this is general or natural revelation. When we have to see the distinction here between natural revelation and what we're going to get into special revelation soon, is this distinction. Natural revelation is things that we can see with our eyes and we can perceive that there is a creator, there is a God. Natural revelation does not and cannot save you. Okay? We can look and see it, and God may use the glory of his heavens, the majesty, as it says in Psalm 8, the majesty of God. When you look and you see, behold, how magnificent he is. You may look at these things and say, wow. And God may use that. But God may use that to draw you to himself, but that natural revelation or general revelation does not save you. It cannot save you. You'll need special revelation, which we're going to get to here in a minute. Now, the other thing that God gives us, so he gives us natural revelation or general revelation, but he also gives us a conscience, okay? Con meaning with, and science meaning knowledge. We have a conscience. We are with knowledge because in the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, and on day six he created man, he has put in every single individual a conscience, and he has given them the moral law. Okay? So the moral law is in the hearts of man. So man knows, whether you've ever heard the special revelation, whether you've ever read scripture, man knows it's not right to steal. It's not right to kill someone. Right? To murder them. Man knows these things. They know that they're doing wrong when they do this. Even in the little tribe somewhere in the middle of nowhere, they know it's wrong to do these things. It may be part of their practice. Their consciences may have become so seared that they don't recognize or realize it at times, because our conscience can become seared, right? The more you're doing wickedness, the more you're doing evil, the more you're rejecting the very nature of God's revelation and the conscience that God has given to you, the more you can sear that. But he's given us a conscience. We are with knowledge, so we are therefore without excuse when we stand before God. Or without excuse. So here's a few. If somebody can grab some of these for me. I'm already in Romans, so I'll grab the first one. But if you can see them on the board, hopefully you guys can see them. If not, Romans 9, 1 through 2, if somebody can grab that. Romans 13, 5. And 1 Peter 2, 19. 1 Corinthians 8, 7. Verse 10 and verse 12. 2 Corinthians 1, 12, and 2 Corinthians 4:2. So Romans 2, 14 and 15 says, "For when Gentiles, who do not have the law, by nature do what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the work of the law is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness, and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them." So, I get this often from Hebrew Israelites. They'll say, "You Gentiles can't sin. You don't have the law." Have you read Romans 2? Paul's saying of these Gentiles, those who don't have the law, but they do what the law commands, show that the law is already written upon their hearts. Now, there's a difference when we read in the New Covenant when God says, "I will write their law upon my hearts." Sometimes people get that confused, where God's saying, we have the written law, we have these things that we know are true, and they're in us by our conscience. But when God talks about in this New Covenant writing upon their heart, writing these laws upon them, no longer on tablets of stone, but now upon the heart, it's referring to, yes, these laws are there, but you've been given now the Spirit of God to actually work these things out and to live these things out. Okay? So, Romans 9, 1 through 2. Who's got that?
"I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it in the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish."
Romans 13, 5.
"Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience."
1 Peter 2:19. We should do Bible drill. Hold up. Caught out.
"For this is a gracious thing when, mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly."
I can go there.
Yeah. 1 Peter 2.
Yeah. 19. Yeah. All right. 1 Corinthians 8:7.
"Howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge, for some with conscience of the idol unto this hour eat it as a thing of offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled."
Verse 10 and verse 12 also.
"For if any man see thee which hast knowledge sit at meat in the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? And through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish for whom Christ died."
And 2 Corinthians 1:12 says, "For our boast is this, the testimony of our conscience, that we have behaved in the world with simplicity and godly sincerity, not by earthly wisdom, but by the grace of God, and supremely so toward you." And 2 Corinthians 4:2. "But we have renounced disgraceful, unhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God." So we have conscience as well. Now, we're going to get into special revelation here, and then we will wrap this one up for this week. So special revelation. Special revelation. The difference between general or natural revelation and special revelation is, the special revelation is how God saves people. I was talking to my cousin at my grandma's funeral, and he's into a lot of New Age kind of Christianity, mysticism, whatnot, and he began talking to me, and I thought to myself, oh no, I'm just going to get myself in trouble here. The funeral, I'm trying to keep peace, I'm trying not to get myself in trouble, but I can't pass up those opportunities. So we're having this conversation, and he said, "Well, I believe there's lots of ways, you know, that people can come to God." Now, he's talking about God from the scriptures. This one, he said, "I believe there's lots of ways people can come to God." He said, you know, some people could be down in the valley, down in the dumps, down depressed, and then they come to God. Some people can be high up here living and everything's great, and then they still come to God. And then people in between, right? I said, yeah, that may be their experience. There's only one way. that they come to God. Every single one of them came the same way. It's through Christ. And it's through the gospel. It's through Christ and it's through the gospel. This person may have an experience of being at their lowest point. God brings the gospel. Somebody comes as a messenger, witnesses. They hear the good news. They get saved. Still the same way. It's still through Christ. Still the same way. The experience may be different for that individual. Every one of us here may have had, we could probably talk about our testimony, and you may have a different testimony than mine as far as how you were brought to that point. But the way is always the same. It's through Christ. And so we talked about that for a little while, and then we talked about a lot of other things, but it's always by the gospel. What is man saved by? Ephesians 2 tells us that it is by grace, through faith, that we're saved. It's not of works, so that we cannot boast, right? And so this faith, how do we receive this faith? Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the words of Christ, or by the words of God, right? So Romans 10, 13 and 7 through 17 says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ." So man comes the same way to God, through faith. And that faith is through hearings. Romans 1 says the gospel, Paul's writing, and he says the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to those who believe, to the Jew first and then also to the Greek. Right? So it is through the gospel message that God saves people. It's always through his word. So this is special revelation. We can read his word that he has inspired, that he is that is infallible, is the word I was looking for, right? And this is God's word. That's special revelation, what God has given to us. Natural revelation, general revelation, we can look around and there's no way man should be able, unless their conscience is so seared or they're in such rebellion. I've heard people say this when it comes to the rebellion of God, because Romans 1 tells us everyone knows God exists. Everyone knows. There's no such thing as an atheist. There are people that claim to be atheists, but there's no such thing. And I've heard it stated by some individuals that it's like going into the ocean or into the beach with a beach ball, right? You've got this beach ball, you're playing, you know, like it's blowing up with your air or whatever. You're just heading it back and forth. But you take that beach ball and you try to stick it under the water. It wants to keep popping back up because of the air that's in it, everything. It just, you can't hold it down. It wants to come back up, right? And that is what it's like when someone is suppressing the truth. The truth streams out. You can't deny the truth, but you're still constantly trying to suppress it. You're trying to push it down, right? And that's what happens when someone is rebelling against the word of God, rebelling against the truth that is there. Because they know these things are true, but they deny them because they want to pursue their own lust and their own desires and their own deeds. So that's as far as we're going to get today. We'll come back and we'll get into more dealing with... That was only 9 slides, so I've got 50. So that, who knows how long this would take us, but it's all good. So let's pray and then we will close out. Any thoughts, any questions, anything come to mind? All right, let's pray. Gracious Lord, we do thank you for your word. We thank you that we can trust that we are holding in our hands your word that guides us in life and practice, that we would live out our faith in accordance with your word. Lord, we know that we are still ever learning, ever growing, and that we don't have it all figured out. But we thank you for your word that it is alive, it is active, it is sharper than a two-edged sword, and every time we read it, it is doing a work in our hearts. Father, may we be obedient to your word. May we always, may you incline our hearts always towards your word, that we would do what your word says, that we would be willing to submit to your word, even when it may feel uncomfortable. Father, help us guide us, lead us, and teach us all things through your word. We pray now that you would be with Pastor Buck as he comes to preach the sermon this morning, that again, your word would do a work in our hearts to change us, to transform us, to renew us afresh, as your mercies are new every morning. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Till this week. So, hang in there with me. Let's give it a try.
Break the speed of mercy.
Just beautiful words. All right, let's go to 157, 157. We do verse 1, verse 2, and end it with verse 1.
Sinful man.